Hello, and a very warm welcome to everyone joining us for today's Select Science webinar, an introduction to method lifecycle management. My name is Sarah Thomas, and I will be moderating today's presentation. I'm delighted to be joined by Dr. Horacio Papa from the United States Pharmacopeia, Dr. Alexander Smith, founder, CEO of and CEO of Chromosent Pharmaceutical Services, and Mia Stanek, co-founder, general manager, and technical director of Chromosent Pharmaceutical Services. Today, we will cover key concepts of method lifecycle management, its benefits to drug manufacturers and patients, and the current thinking of the USP, FDA, and ICH. Alexander and Mio will then present case studies of how life cycle management is being implemented at Chromosent Pharmaceutical Services. After the presentation, we'll move on to our question and answer session, so please feel free to ask any questions for the Q&A session at any time during the webinar. You can submit your question at the bottom of your screen. Without further delay, I'd like to hand over to our speakers for today's presentation, and I would like to thank them for presenting to us today. Please go ahead, Horacio.
Okay. So the topic today is about a new proposed chapter in USP, Chapter 1220, the Analytical Procedure Lifecycle. Technically speaking, this is not yet a formal proposal from USP. I will explain this later. But I think it's a good tool to alert the users of USP that we are working in this particular topic. There is a series of chapters in USP that discuss the topic validation and associated other topics. Everybody knows Chapter 1225, validation of compendial procedures. This chapter was introduced in USP in 1990, and in fact was the precursor of ICHQ2. It focused mostly on chromatographic procedures, probably because it's a more comprehensive validation protocol, but it can be extended to other analytical procedures. Later in time, we included in USP Chapter 1226, verification of compendial procedures, and 1224, transfer of analytical procedures. In some way, this was the intention of this was creating the quality assurance in all the stages of analytical procedures, since its inception by validation and then the verification when this procedure is coming from a compendia, and finally 1224, the transfer of analytical procedure when the method is not in the pharmacopoeia. However, they were written at different times, and there is not a good integration between them. There is a recently we include a new member in this family, Chapter 1210, Statistical Tools for Procedure Validation, that was created with the intention of being a companion chapter of 1225. Recognizing that in order to obtain reliable results from validation, you have to use statistical methods to handle the data originated during the validation. In recent years, we decided to take a look to more in depth to the validation definition. And as you can see, for USP and even for many other groups, the definition of validation is almost the same and talks about is the process by which it is established by laboratory studies that the performance characteristics of a procedure meet the requirements for the intended analytical application. So two very important components. First of all, validation is always performed through laboratory studies. There's a series of experiments around the validation. And the second and the more important is the definition. Is that validation is the procedure to determine if the method is suitable for the intended use, is fit for the purpose. Now, if you look how validation is performed in 1225 or even in ICH Q2, you will realize that it's a series of experiments where you have to perform the experiment or not, The table you have in the screen is the typical table that is the base for the validation and also for the verification in some way. So the document tells you what to do, but there is not a clear determination through this experiment if the method is suitable for the intended use. Just to remind you, there are four categories in the analytical procedures, at least in 1225. ICAQ2 is slightly different. Category one represent those analytical procedures where the analyte is usually the main component in your analytical matrix. In general, the assay of an API or the assay of a in a drug product. The category two represent the impurity testing. This may be a quantitative test, or maybe a limit test. Depending on how the method is developed, you will choose one or the other option. Category three is a unique category in the USP chapter in 1225 and represent those methods that are designed to demonstrate the performance of a dosage form. For example, those analytical procedures using the solution or in content uniformity. And finally, we have category four, which represent identity tests, where the only performance characteristic that needs to be tested is the specificity. But again, looking into this table, there is no clear indication about how to demonstrate the suitability for the intended use. Looking into this question and also thinking in how the industry will perform validation in the next 15 or 20 years, we decided to create an advisory panel in, I think it was in 2012, with this idea. We asked these experts try to envision how validation will be conceived in the future. After a series of discussion, this expert panel clearly embraced the concept of quality by design that were expressed in ICHQA, Q9 and Q10, and went to the process of translating those concepts into the analytical world. And I think that was one of the first steps in developing this concept of analytical QVD. This expert panel produced was in 2013. What you see in the screen is the title and the abstract. This paper was published in the Pharmacopeial Forum in the volume 39, issue 5. And I have to say that the Pharmacopeia Forum is publicly available, so you can access the publication through our website, www.usp.org. If you look at briefly at the abstract, you will see that the intention of the expert panel is to see the traditional concept of validation, transfer, and verification as a unique process that follows the life cycle of the method. And the more important is that this process will start with a predefined objective. And this predefined objective establishes what is the fit for purpose, what is the suitable for the intended use for the method. And we will call this the analytical target profile. Following that paper, there were four more papers and three workshops. The three following papers to the first one, you can see on the screen, one in PS42.2. The title was Fitness for the Use, Decision Rules and Target Measurement Uncertainty. Following that one, Analytical Target Profile, Structure and Application through the Analytical Life Cycle, and finally, the Analytical Control Strategy. These three papers have the purpose to go in depth into three concepts that were not not previously included in the validation process and the performance verification of the method. So So I think it is important to review all these three papers to better understand the concept in 2020. As I said before, there were three workshops, two in the U.S., one in Europe, that also allowed interested parties in participating in the discussions. And finally, the last document is in Pharmacopeia Forum 43.1, one article titled The Analytical Lifecycle 2020 as a new proposed chapter. As I say at the beginning, this is not in the USP language, this is not yet a formal proposal. This was presented as a stimuli article, which means that our intention is to use this article to promote a discussion about the need for this document into the USP and the content. So the next step you will see is probably during next year or the end of this year, a publication of chapter 1220 as a formal proposal into the Pharmacopeia Board. In a few words, the life cycle proposed in chapter 1220 contains three stages. The first stage is based on the analytical target profile previously defined, the stage where the method is developed. During the stage two, we will do what is called here procedure performance qualification. This is what we normally call method validation. Stage two is actually the demonstration that the method as it was developed is able to provide an analytical result which is acceptable for the analytical target profile previously defined. And finally, the third stage is how we will continue verify that the method is performing within the space previously defined in the analytical target profile. There is a discussion about what are the activities into the stage two, because I have to say also that for the purpose of the pharmacopeia, the more important part is the definition of the analytical target profile and of the procedure performance qualification. And for many authors, the stage two is simply to demonstrate that the method is precise and accurate within the range established. And all the other performance characteristics as previously described in ICHU2, like limit of detection, limit of quantitation, robustness, linearity, etc., or response solution if you want, all those aspects belong to the method development. So when you reach the performance qualification, the only thing you have to do is to demonstrate that the accuracy and precision, and the accuracy and precision demonstrated as a one total error or total measurement uncertainty, depending on the case you prefer, is measured. Again, this is a work in progress. So I envision that there will be more discussion around this. In fact, the idea of moving from the concept of validation to the performance qualification was clearly criticized during the first publication of the article, because validation is a term that is well established in the community. Again, I think one of the more important and unique element of the life cycle approach is the establishing of the analytical target profile. This is an element that you will do upfront before probably choosing the appropriate method, and it's based on the external requirements. Is not associated with the analytical procedure, is associated with the need of the analytical data you will produce. So based on the analytical target profile, you will choose the appropriate method, and you will develop that method around the analytical target profile. And what you will including this analytical profile, is the all the maximum uncertainty or sources of variation that you can accept in your analytical result. Just to clarify the concept, what you see here is a certain specification, the upper limit of the specification, and four possible results. In the result number one and result number four, it is clear that in one case the result is outside the upper limit, and in the number four is below the upper limit. So there is no any question there. The problem is when your result is close to the limit. And then you have the case two and case three. In those cases, when you consider the standard uncertainty of the result, considering a normal result of data, you will see that there are a certain number of values that by probability are outside or inside the limit. So the question, in order to determine what is the appropriate suitability for the method is how much you can accept, how much overlap you can accept in making the decision. Because keep in mind that those that tail of the Gauss distribution that is outside or inside is probability of making the wrong decision. So. And that is the question you have to answer through the ATP. If you look at the future, the question we have is how this may impact the USP monograph, the USP standards. And there are many aspects that have to be considered. One, for example, is the fact that if your acceptance criteria, if your ATP will be based on some kind of a statistical language, for example, some kind of a statistical interval that should include the actual result, that implies that the result needs to be the final result or the reportable value should be derived from a series of determination. As you may know, that the monograph in a pharmacopoeia usually describes a single determination. It's one standard, one sample. However, moving in this direction, this may imply that the monograph should establish a replication strategy. So in other words, that the result, the reportable result should be obtained based on a specific number of replications. This may also give us a chance to go back to the concept of the performance-based monograph, which is something that we discussed in the past. Then this discussion was abandoned for many reasons. Now, with this idea of validation, there's another opportunity to describe in the monograph the appropriate ATP or the analytical target profile for the method, so users may use the method described in a monograph or any other method that describe that meet the requirements in the ATP. And this may perfectly fit with the concept of equivalent or better, which is described in the USP general notices. From the side of the regulators, I have to say that there is still debate about the use of analytical QVD in applications. What we know at this time is that in general, the regulators will accept the ATP as a form of a qualifier for the expected performance of a method. However, they are not fully convinced that based on the ATP, you can transfer or you can migrate from, let's say, a chromatographic method to a spectroscopic method. But yes, it is easier to migrate from different HPLC methods, for example. So this is, again, is a work in progress. And finally, I think that this discussion and discussions in other groups like in Europe, FPA and other groups, with the start of the discussion of the validation, it was a good time to go back to ICHQ2 and see how it can be modernized. Keep in mind that ICHQ2 have been in place for more than almost 30 years. So recently, ICH established an informal group to revise ICHQ2. The first decision of this this group was to tackle the revision of ICHQ2 by creating two standards. One is the actual Q2, which will be modernized by including new techniques, especially those based on chemometric models like near infrared, and the Q14, which is a new standard that has the purpose to provide guidance on analytical procedure development and probably looking into the ICAQA, the analytical target profile, et cetera, all those concepts. Here I have to say that the intention of the chapter 1220 is to cover the whole life cycle. So in the same chapter, at the end of the development of the document, you should have what is the method development requirements or guidances, what is the analytical validation guidances, and what is the performance qualification guidances. And with that, I only have to give you the last message. As you know, USP is being renovated every 5 years. And at this point, we are preparing the convention for the next 5 years. The convention will be in 2020, and we'll establish the Council of Experts between 2020 and 2025. That means that the open for candidates to be part of the USP Expert Committee and Expert Panel is now on the website. So if you are interested in participating in the USP process, just go to the website. You have all the information in the slide. Go to the website and apply according to your expertise. And as I can tell you, in my experience with USP, scientists find a very rewarding activity to participate in the USP process. With that, I think I'm finished. I want to thank you for your attention, and I will pass the microphone to our next speaker, Alexander. Thank you.
Yes, thank you very much, and hello to everybody. In the following, we will present three real cases, how we implement lifecycle management of analytical methods. So currently, we have isolated activities for compendial method verification, for method development and validation, and for transfer of method to get an analytical method into routine use. That creates an increased risk of method failures, and there should be a better way. The ICH guidelines Q8, 9, 10, and 11 were implemented between 2005 and 2012 and introduced a scientific and risk-based systematic approach in development. Even that the ICH Q8 does not explicitly discuss analytical method development, the same concepts apply. So, and the benefits would be development of a robust method by using a systematic quality-by-design approach, deeper understanding on how critical factors influence method performance, and the implementation of lifecycle principles to analytical methods would improve reliability by understanding, reducing, and controlling sources of variability. And we would gain regulatory flexibilities, because moving within the analytical design space are not considered a change of the method. As we already heard today, that the USP is a forerunner and published some stimuli articles and proposed a new general chapter 1220 on method lifecycle management. We already have seen that the FDA included a lifecycle management section in their new validation guidance and recognized the benefits of it. The lifecycle concept starts with the ATP, the expectation of the analytical method to develop, and addresses accuracy, precision, and specificity. In stage one, it is the method design, the development of a new method, and the gain of knowledge about the new method. In the stage two, it is the method performance qualification, actually the current validation, robustness testing, and transfer of a method. And in stage three is continued method performance verification, the monitoring of the performance of a method when it is in routine use. If data indicating that the method is not operating as expected, the root cause should be investigated. And the outcome of the investigation may be a change of the method. And the nature of the change dictates the actions that should be taken, for example, revalidation or redevelopment of the method. Lifecycle concepts helps to control sources of variability resulting in fewer OOS results and convince regulators and inspectors about the knowledge of a new method. Let's see how it works in a real case. Initial situation is the official HPLC purity method of Ebastin published in the European Pharmacopoeia. The runtime is unbelievable, 160 minutes, and the peak width for the API peak is 8 minutes. I think this method should be redeveloped. This is a flowchart of the analytical quality by design approach, which we are following at Comisend. It starts with the ATP, the definition of method's goal and expectation for the analytical method to develop. And it follows by risk assessment to identify critical quality attributes, design of experiments in screening and optimization phase, building an analytical design space, or also called a method operable design region, the selection of a working point within the analytical design space, and performing a verification study, followed by method validation and robustness testing. After validation, a control strategy, which could be a system stability test, will be implemented. Continuous improvement is possible when necessary. So now let us go it step by step. First step, it starts with the ATP, with the expectations for the analytical method to develop and addresses accuracy, precision, and specificity. In our case study, it is a baseline separation of all components with a resolution higher than 2. For the purity method, a limit of quantification for impurities smaller than 0.01%. For assay, for the assay part of the method, a precision lower than 2.0% and accuracy 100% plus minus 3%. The analysis this time should be smaller than 10 minutes. Second step is the risk assessment to identify influential parameters, which could be, or which is in our case, the column chemistry, the gradient time, the temperature, the ternary composition of the eluent, and the pH of the eluent. Currently, we have over 1,000 columns on the market, and the selection of a column is not very easy. So we like vary these column selection chart with columns of different vendors in it. Each blue, light blue dot stands for a column, and we highlighted all acuity columns because they are available in sub 2 micron particle sizes, and we choose 4 columns with orthogonal properties. In this case, with different hydrophobicities and selectivities for the screening of the column and the eluent combination. For each of the 4 columns, we performed linear gradients with methanol, acetonitrile, and isopropanol on an UPLC H-class system. The system consists of a solvent manager with solvent selection valve for up to 9 solvents, a column manager up to 4 columns and different temperature zones, and a PDA and QDA single MS detector for easy peak tracking. in the optimization phase, the best combination of column and iller end will be used for a new design of experiments in which we have to perform 12 runs with a lower and a higher temperature, with a short and a long gradient time, and different ternary composition of the organic LO end. From the first four corner experiments, we used our Dry Lab software to create critical resolution maps. Here, on the x-axis, the gradient time, on the y-axis, the temperature, and the color code stands for the critical resolution. The red area shows a resolution higher than 2, and the blue area a coelution of peaks. And here we can see that with pure acetonitrile in the organic LO end, we cannot separate all peaks from each other because we don't have a red area. From the next four runs with 30% isopropanol and acetonitrile, we create the second layer. From the last four runs with 60% isopropanol and acetonitrile, we see a huge red area in which separation of all peaks should be possible. The Dry Lab software can create and three-dimensional model, a cube, out of the 12 experiments performed. See the red areas here isolated in the cube, which is the analytical design space or the method operable design region in which we choose now a working point. What we have created with the Dry Lab software is a model. And now we should verify the model. So we perform runs at the working point and at six different verification points around the working point and compare the experimental retention times with the predicted ones. From the graph on the right side, you can see that the correlation coefficient of 0.9996 indicates a perfect correlation between the model and real experiments. The next step is the method validation, and we show that we could successfully validate the method in compliance with the ICH Q2 guidance. And then a robustness testing of the method was performed. So for the six chromatographic parameters shown here, a gradient time, temperature, ternary composition of the organic LO end, the flow rate, percent start and percent end of the gradient, each at three levels in a full factorial design, we have to perform 729 experiments. But we have constructed and verified a model. We can use this robustness the robustness module within the Dry Lab software for robustness testing and perform the robustness test in silico. Here you can see the first 10 and the last 10 runs of the 729 experiments. In the column, we see the parameters which were changed, and in the last column, the resulting critical resolution of impurities or of the peaks. And for all 729 experiments, we received a critical resolution higher than 2. That means the method is very robust. From our knowledge gained about the performance of the method, we implemented a system stability test as the only control element needed, which is the resolution of the impurities C and D. And if necessary, for example, because of method-related OOS results, the method can be changed within the analytical design space or the method operable design region. Changes within the analytical design space is not a regulatory variation. So that is the new and final UPLC method for Ebastin. It is based on a scientific and risk-based analytical quality by design approach. All previous defined method goals were met, the baseline separation of the components of interest, the resolution are higher than 2. The acceptance criteria for validation are fully met. The analysis time you can see here is 3 or 4 minutes, which is an impressive 40-fold increase in productivity in comparison to the official method. And yeah, and details about the quality by design approach can be found in our literature. Case study number 2. In which we will explain the verification and troubleshooting of an already existing official method. It is regarding the pramipexole method, adapted from the European Pharmacopoeia and the United States Pharmacopoeia. When we performed the method in our lab, we saw day-to-day variations in the form of changes in the elution order of the two last peaks, indicating that the method is not very robust. To evaluate the problem, we performed a set of 4 experiments with the working point in the center. So instead of 15 minutes gradient time, we reduced the gradient time to 5 minutes and increased the gradient time to 25 minutes, and performed the runs at lower temperature, 30 degrees, and higher temperature, 50 degrees. Once again, we can create with the dry lab software a critical resolution map. And once again, the red area is a robust area. Changes, here we can see that changes of the temperature will not have an effect on the resolution, but on the gradient time. A longer gradient time will result in peak co-elution, while at shorter gradient time, the method would be more robust. We also checked the LON knowledge space for robustness, because the aqueous LON contains a buffer and the ion pair reagent. Therefore, we performed experiments with different buffer and ion pair concentration, and we saw at the resulting resolution map that the working point is exact at the edges of failure. With a reduction of the ion pair concentration, the method would be more robust. So the conclusion is the current official method for pramipexole causes OOS results because of missing robustness. An analytical quality by design approach indicating that missing robustness is caused by buffer and the ion pair reagent in the aqueous LON. Adjustment of the ion pair reagent concentration or the gradient time in compliance to the USP chapter 621 solved the problem. Once again, you can find details about this case study in our publication. And for the third case study, I will now give over to Miu.
Thank you, Alexander. So case study number 3. QBD analytical method development using SFC. The initial situation this time is for carbamazepine published in the Pharmacopoeia with a runtime of 110 minutes, where you can see that carbamazepine and impurity B are co-eluting and impurity E is not really a peak. So after a risk assessment, we identify influential parameters as stationary phase, gradient time, temperature, maybe additives, start and end percent B of the gradient, and flow rate. So these parameters we took into a screening and optimization part. In the screening part, we fixed the flow rate on the left side, the initial and final strong solvent. What we checked and tried to screen is the eluent as methanol, isopropanol, and isonitrile. And we also checked the gradient time, the oven temperature, and 4 different columns. The Fusion QBD software can build in DOE where we include all these parameters with the ranges we want to check with 57 runs. We performed the experiments on a UPC square system where we have a detector, a PDA detector as a normal detector, an ELSD, to see possible PDA invisible peaks, and also an MS detector that can also see possible invisible peaks and also for peak tracking. The color manager, where we can use up to four columns. The results were implemented in the Fusion software. And what we receive is a 2D graph with gradient time against oven temperature. And to explain a little bit the color code, the response in this case is to find all eight peaks. And in the graph, you can see a red color and a white color. The red color means the goal is not met, and the white color is our design space where the goal is met. Software, we can also implement other responses like resolution or symmetry factor. And at the end, we receive a multicolor graph. We can also check that for all columns and all LUNs, where we have 12 2D graphs, where you can see that we only have with methanol a white area and with two columns. Because the white area of the 2EP column is much bigger than for the diol column, the 2EP column and methanol were checked in the optimization. The optimization, we fixed also the gradient time and the final percent strong solvent, and we checked for flow rate, initial percent strong solvent, and oven temperature. As a response, this time we have chosen the number of peaks to find all eight peaks and to have a resolution of 1.5 for all peaks. You can see in the three 2D graphs that the goal is only met with an oven temperature of 30 degrees and with a low initial percent strong solvent. With this knowledge, we created a second optimization part. We fixed the oven temperature, the gradient time, and the initial percent strong solvent. And this time we checked the eluent, where we used methanol, methanol with formic acid, and methanol with ammonia. We also checked the flow rate and the final percent strong solvent. This time the responses were receive a resolution of 2 or higher for all peaks. The last peak retention time to reduce the runtime, and the symmetry factor of carbamazepine and all other peaks. You can see that the goal is only met by using methanol with ammonia, where we have a big white area at higher flow rates and higher final percent strong solvents. Now we can choose a working point that you can see here in the middle. And these are the conditions of the new working point. So the software showed only a prediction. Now we have to verify and test for robustness. For the robustness test, we have identified three most critical parameters during the development. And these are flow rate, initial percent strong solvent, and the oven temperature. We check them in three levels, upper, lower, and nominal level. The Fusion QBD software calculated a new DOE with 22 runs. It was performed and and the results were implemented back to the software. Here we can see a multi 2D graphs where you can see all combinations that are possible. As a response, of course, we checked for to see all peaks. We checked for the resolution of all peaks. We checked for the last retention time, last peak retention time, and also for the first peak retention time so that the first peak is not co-eluting with the injection peak, and for the symmetry factor. And in the graphs, you can see that about around the working point is enough white space. So that shows that the method is very robust. The software can also show you a predicted chromatogram on the right side. And in the comparison, you can see in the upper chromatogram, that's the old method, and on the lower chromatogram, you can see the new developed method. Here you can see that impurity E on the beginning of the chromatogram looks like a normal peak now. We have separated the API and impurity B, and we have implemented additional impurity F in this approach. The peak is not visible in the old method because it was not performed at this time. So, conclusion, all previous defined methods goals were met. We received a baseline separation of all components with a resolution higher than 2. We received a symmetry factor for all components lower than 1.5. We have implemented an additional impurity to the new method, and with an analysis time of only 4 minutes with equilibration time, we received an impressive 23-fold increase in productivity. The method is currently in the validation, and we will publish this approach, and I hope in the next few weeks it should be finalized. So, thank you for your interest.
And also from Alexander, thank you very much.
Thank you, Horacio, Alexander, and Mio for your great presentations. It's now time to move on to the question and answer session. So we'll try and answer as many questions as possible. And if we're unable to answer any remaining questions in the time permitted, we'll try and provide you an answer via email in the coming days. So our first question here for Alexander, I believe, is what is your strategy to qualify for MODR? The validation at each extreme points of the MODR is challenging for pharmaceutical companies.
It's Mio. After we receive a design space, it's often only a model. Afterwards, like you have seen in the presentation, we perform some verification points, of course, a working point, and mostly 6 points around the working point, sometimes also outside of the MODR or design space, also to check if the knowledge space shows not only where it's good, so we verify also points where the method it's not good. So afterwards in the validation, we don't perform any robustness tests anymore because we have performed it during the or in the end of the development.
Great, thanks, Mia. So our next question here, with regards to the ATP, do you think it's important to qualify the method and determine the TMU acceptance criteria at each step of the pharmaceutical development?
And I think that is for me. The first comment I have to do here is keep in mind that USP usually focuses on those methods that are used in the final stages of the development, so when the product is already in the market. Having said that, the answer is usually not. You don't need to put a lot of effort in methods that are developed during the process of the product development, and I think of it's the same parallel that we use we do now for classical validation. The big effort in the validation is when the method is already defined with the product already developed.
Great, thanks. We'll move on to our next question here. Are draft versions of ICH Q2 R2 and ICH Q14 available?
No, yet. The expectation is that the first readable version will be discussed at the next meeting in June in Amsterdam. And after that, I think you should expect to see the document on the ICH website in probably a couple of months.
Great. Our next question is, are you able to peak track unknown impurities, unknown masses, at the 0.05 level relative to the main peak with the QDA?
It depends, of course, of the analyte and of the method, of course. Usually, yes, but sometimes it also happens that higher peaks are not detectable with MS. They have to be ionized, and everything depends on the ionization.
Thank you. Next question here is, in quality by design for methods, what is the support to define precision for samples in accuracy less than 3%?
Not just for quality by design, but also in the approach we took in our new chapter 1210 that proposed a statistical method for procedure validation. We promote the use of the total error approach, where you can have accuracy and precision all together as one parameter. So no matter how high or low is your precision or your accuracy, provided that when you put all the both together, the total error is within what you define in your ATP.
Thanks, Horacio. We'll move on to our next question. If there are three laboratories in one firm, R&D and QC lab on two locations, our opinion is that methods validated out of house should be verified in all three laboratories, or if validated in R&D, they should be transferred and verified in both QC labs. Do you agree?
Yeah, I would say yes. The basic concept is you will validate the method that is not in the pharmacopeia, has not been validated before, and you verify the methods that are in the compendia. And you will transfer the methods that are not in the compendia. However, when you are moving compendial methods from one lab to the other, is not a clear line between verification and transfer. What is important, I think, to answer the question is that the verification activity is laboratory dependent, because within the verification process, you try to demonstrate that the conditions where the method will be performed are suitable. And that includes not just the analytical matrix of your sample, but also the laboratory conditions.
Thanks, Horacio. We'll move on to our next question. So, Horacio, you mentioned that linearity, QL, is in fact part of the method development, and only precision and accuracy is needed for the validation. Does that mean that the official validation protocol written would not include these tests, but only precision and accuracy? And what is then included in the final validation report needed for filing of a method?
Well, first, I need to clarify that this is kind of a idea or a model that is being discussed today. There's nothing on the near horizon that indicate that you will have to change your filings or even the validation protocol that you have to submit to the pharmacopeia. Are just ideas, again, in theory, what some groups believe is that when you define the total error in the range that the method needs to operate, again, accuracy and precision, and within the range, there is nothing else needed to define the performance of the method in that region. Things like linearity, and understanding linearity as the response function of the method, or even the limit of quantitation, which is defined at the minor, the lowest concentration that can be measured by with appropriate accuracy and precision. As you can see, all those things are secondary parameters of the main accuracy and precision combination. So you define those during the method development based on your ATP, and then the validation or the qualification, depending what will be the final terminology, will be just accuracy and precision. But again, this is, as I said in my presentation, this is a work in progress, and not everybody is agree in the same concept. I try to present all the current ideas.
Okay, thank you for that. Our next question is for Alexander and Mio, and that is, how much total analyst or manager time was required to address the issues in the case studies presented?
For the Evastin case study, we worked on it for 2 weeks. And the Pamipexol case study, it was a little bit quicker. I think it was done in 2 days or so.
And for the third case study, I needed 2 weeks, but you have for all three case studies, they are very easy. So sometimes we also need up to 2 months for very difficult method development.
Great, thank you both. Our next question here, which modeling system do you recommend, Dry Lab or Fusion?
It's a difficult question. It depends what you want to do, and both softwares have their benefits. For in DryLab, you can change, for example, many parameters like gradient time, percent start, percent end. You can implement gradient steps. You can change your column dimensions, the flow rate, the dwell volume. After you receive the knowledge space, and you can see what the chromatogram should like. In Fusion, you have the benefit you can implement every response you receive or result in your chromatographic system. It doesn't matter, is it tailing factor, is it peak high, recovery, resolution. So it depends on the user, what is the focus.
Great, thanks. We have our next question here for Horacio. How is quality by design considered in the change permitted for the chapter 621?
Okay, thank you. That's a good question. Looking into the, not in the near future, in the far future, when the methods that were developed and validated using QBD concept, the information we will obtain as a pharmacopeia in terms of the performance of the method, considering the potential accuracy and precision of the method, the conditions where the method will run, with the appropriate, meeting the appropriate system strategy requirements, that information will be very handy and available in the process of creating the monograph. So in other words, all the adjustment that we propose in 621 will not be needed anymore, because the information will contain all the information, the monograph will contain all the information necessary for introduce acceptable adjustments in the method. The adjustment in 621 were introduced as temporary solution because the lack of specific information on the design space of the method. So when this is implemented, probably the adjustment in 61 will not be needed anymore.
Okay, thank you. We've got time for one last question, and that is the technique applicable to any HPLC system?
I think the question was about SFC technique. You can use the columns for normal phase, but it's not. You cannot compare it one by one. So it can be checked for a screening. Does a normal phase make sense, yes or no, but the development is completely different.
Okay, thank you. So that's all we have time for today. So thank you very much to Horacio, Alexander, and Mio for presenting to us today and for your great discussion at the end. And thank you to everyone joining us online and for your interesting questions. So I hope that you've all found this a worthwhile session. If you didn't manage to answer your question, then please feel free to email me at sarah@selectscience.net and I can pass your questions on to our speakers. Remember, you can also download a certificate of attendance in the related resources tab at the bottom right of your screen. And if you'd like to listen again to today's webinar or to invite a friend to listen, it will be available to watch on demand in a few days' time. So goodbye, and thank you once again for joining us.